of the Terracotta Warriors, the first emperor and his legacy. As you know, the Terracotta Warriors were firstly excavated in 1974. In the following decades, about 1,000 Terracotta Warriors have been excavated, and some of them have been restored. But so far, the majority of the army is still buried. Here you can see this is a photograph. This is a photo of the of Piece 1. In this excavation, let's start with the British interior. In this section, we will talk about in the first section of this show, we talk about the Qin culture and the Qin people. This is the one I mentioned. I just mentioned. This is a boar bell. Excavated from Baoji. You can see it features the four-flanged design with a high-relief dragon and phoenix design. On the base, it bears a long inscription of 135 characters. It reads, the Duke of Qin says, "My foremost ancestor has received heavenly mandate and was awarded with a residence and through the country by heavenly mandate." Can we move on? Before the first emperor's unification of China, the country was ruled by kings of Zhou, and Qin people claimed themselves subjects of the Zhou king. They followed the rituals and etiquette advocated by the rulers of the Zhou dynasty. Their embrace of the Zhou rituals is reflected in the massive production of bronze vessels. One of them you can see is a bell. It's here in this showcase. We have more bronze vessels. One is the bronze vessel named the He. He is used for heating up food and containing liquids. This He is very beautiful in design. You can see it features the relief work on the body. The handle is shaped in the form of a tiger who is going to kiss a phoenix. This form of He is very typical of the. It's a very typical style of the Jin state. It reflects. It shows a bilateral relationship with Jin and Qin people. Dagger with a beautiful golden hilt. The blade of the dagger is made of pure iron. This dagger was made in the spring and autumn period. During that time, iron was a kind of very precious metal. The value of iron may be the same as gold. This dagger was made for ceremonial use. Purpose, not for real battle. We show some jade ritual objects. According to the rituals of Zhou, all these jade have specific meanings. For example, the round disc was used for worshipping heaven, while the squarish tree, Cong, was used for worshipping earth. These three objects were also used for some rituals or ceremonies. For example, this arc-shaped pendant named the Huang, it was used for the rituals for water and the direction north. The one in the middle is called the Zhang. It was used for. It was often associated with fire and south. And this this arc-shaped pendant named the Xi. It's used for some rituals of passage. This one, I want you to show you this beaker. This is this beaker was made of a local jade from Shanxi. It was excavated from the site of the Epang Palace. Epang Palace was one of the most famous Chinese palaces because it was built by the first emperor himself, but it was burnt down shortly after the Qin Dynasty collapse. This beaker was believed to use to collect dew, because the first emperor, he was crazy about pursuing longevity and immortality, and the pre-Qin people believed when the elixir was taken with the dew, you can get longevity. Yeah. Okay, let's move on. Showcase, you can see the incense burner decorated with a phoenix on the top. The sphere is made by the method of lobster wax. It's a special method invented by the people. And the base is composed of some small warriors and tigers. The incense was put in the sphere, but now it can't be opened now because it has been seized by corrosion. This one was excavated from Yongcheng, one of Qin's old capitals. Can we move on? The king of Qin, he started building his own mausoleum. The Qin mausoleum was quite huge. It occupies an area of 56 square kilometers. In this area, there are a lot of architectures on the ground and underground. The core of the mausoleum, of course, is the subterranean palace under the tomb mound. It acquires an area of two soccer fields, quite huge area. And the coffin of the first emperor is buried underground about 35 meters. In the Qin mausoleum area, besides the center subterranean palace, there are also over 400 burials in this huge area. In this show, we selected some important objects excavated from the Qin mausoleum. Let's see this one. This is a set of stone armor. In one of the archaeological excavations in 1999, archaeologists found a pit full of thousands of small stone plates. At first, people were very perplexed. Nobody knew what they were used for. But later, archaeologists realized that they were used to make armor and helmets. In this pit, there are about 150 sets of armor and 50 helmets, and one armor made for horse. The armor and helmets were made of limestone. As we know, limestone is very heavy and fragile. So this armor and helmets were not made for real battle. They were made for the burial purpose. here in this showcase, we have a bronze bird, a bronze crane. This bronze crane was unearthed from a peak at the north of the mausoleum, very far from the center of Tomb Mound, about two kilometers far away from the Tomb Mound. In this piece, people also found some terracotta musicians. The terracotta musicians were playing some musical instruments to feed the birds. So the terracotta army reflected the military aspect of the first emperor's life. And the terracotta musicians and this bronze bird reflect another aspect, the entertaining aspect of the first emperor's life. This bronze man was excavated from the Angkor Wat pit near the tomb. In the same pit, people found several kinds of Angkor Wat and restored six of them. You can see he's very very strong, very tall. Without head, it's still 172 cm. If with head, maybe over 2 meters high. Besides this terracotta acrobat, people also found a bronze thing, a very massive bronze thing. The weight is over 400 kg, and people believe this guy, maybe he was a weightlifter, because in the Qing court, sitting tripod thing was a very popular sport in the Qing court. Terracotta army piece, the entire Qin army is represented. When we selected the artifacts for this show, we tried to cover as many types as possible. So on this platform, you can see different types of terracotta warriors. First of all, you can see this is a general. A general, also called a high-ranking military official. He can be identified by his distinctive high dress and the tassel on the upper chest and the back of the on the armor. He has long spear. He's taller than other soldiers. He's more imposing. His weight is about 300 kg. So far, there are nine terracotta generals excavated and restored. We are very lucky to have him in this show. Shall we go to that? Light infantry official. You can see he's on armor. In terracotta pit number one, in pit one, there are about 200 light infantry men were placed in the front of the army. This one is a military official. He can be identified by his hat. And he's holding a shield, maybe a long weapon in the right hand. As a military official, he's also a bit taller than other common soldiers. This is a charioteer. From the posture of his hand, you can see he's holding reins in his hand. he stands on the chariot. Usually one or two other terracotta soldiers standing beside him to protect him. In the pre-Qin period, as we know, cavalry had not developed to be the main force of the army. The military chariots were the main part of the army. As usual, there were another 5 to 8 infantry soldiers around the chariot to form a military formation. This is a standing archer. From the posture of his hand, we can see he held a bow in his hand. He's from his tool. In his tool, there are two types of archer, standing and kneeling. The standing archer usually stand around or behind the kneeling archer. I'd like to show you some weapons from the from Tip 1. This weapon, the long sword, arrowhead, and the crossbow trigger mechanism, they were all of them were excavated from Tip 1. This sword is very special because it's chromium plated, so it doesn't rust.
Does that still exist today in
yes,
China?
Yes, yes.
Or you still have that kind of metal? Right.
Okay, let's move on. This figure is an armored military official. You can see he's more reddish than other figures. This color may be caused by burning, by fire. Because when the Terracotta Army, soon after the Terracotta Army was buried, the pit, or the three pits were looted and burned. Some of them, like this one, the color, the pigments, they were originally painted with brilliant pigments, but after the fire, the pigments have gone. Achieved by the Qin artifacts. Archery is one of the six noble arts, and also a basic military skills required by all soldiers. In all these terracotta armies, the kneeling archer is often of the best quality. Yeah.
We're now entering the third section of the exhibition, which is the part about the legacy. And before us and towards the end, we see many objects from the Western Han period and some from the Eastern Han period. Within this showcase, there was this part here was the piece which I highlighted earlier. They were actually excavated from a tomb that contained about 2,500 figures, and they were all neatly packed together in 10 pits. So from the scale of the entourage that was buried, we can tell that it probably belonged to a Han general of a high level. And this site is actually associated with the grave complex of the first Han emperor, Gao Zu. who defeated his rival Xiang Yu, and then they established the Han Empire in 202 CE. What is interesting is that in contrast to the Terracotta Army of the Tin, the pigments are retained here, and you can see that instead of sculpted details, as you can see of the Terracotta Army, all these details are painted, so you can actually still see the remnants of the armor on this figure. And if you look around, you can see that the saddle and other details on the horse are painted. So although the figures are simpler, they still have the kind of realism that we see that is continued into a Han funerary art. Okay, I would highlight, this was the other object which I highlighted earlier. This is the jade bear, a very delicate object. But in contrast to, well, maybe pre-tin art or art of spring and autumn or warring state spirits, is the kind of realism. Because animals used to be represented in a more abstract format, but from tin and then towards the Han, we see a new direction in the way art was represented. I will take you through another area. Okay, the objects in the showcases encircling us, these pieces come from Yang Ling, which is the great complex of the fourth Han Emperor Xing Ti. And what is interesting about them is that these figures are now all naked, but they were all once dressed in silk robes, and they had actually movable arms which, you know, could be inserted into the sockets that you see now remain. So in a way, they were able to fashion reality even more than perhaps the clay figures. And something else that is interesting to note is that although they were clothed, genitalia is actually represented, although it was not for anyone to see. And if you notice, this figure here looks like the first two figures, but these are warrior figures, and this is actually a eunuch. And he's the earliest archaeological evidence of the presence of eunuchs in the Western Han court. And just in case you're wondering, these are actually horsemen who would have rode on wooden horses that have also disintegrated with time. And something that we see in Han pits that was not present in perhaps, in the first emperor's tomb complex is a huge presence of animals. Actually, rows and rows of animals were buried, and here we've only shown a collective group. Because animals were a very important source of course, food and labor, and these are among five of the six so-called domesticated animals in China. The only animal that we have not represented here is the horse. There was also seen in tombs. This is another of our what is called a first great cultural relic. And something again that we see in Han tombs was that shift towards a more domestic setting. There was a greater need to cater for the idea of recreation and amusement in the afterlife. So we see many ladies who may be attendant figures or musicians, so she maybe could have held a tin in the hand, and then she was probably plucking the string. So I guess with that, we'll conclude our tour. So if you have any questions, just let us know.